Hello, John Talley here with Partzilla.com, and welcome back to our top-end build on our 2009 Yamaha YFZ450R. As you can tell, I've already got it broken down, so let's head over to the table, look at the tools and the parts we're going to need to get this put back together, and then we'll dive into it. So let's go. Welcome to the tool bench. Listen, depending on which episode you're watching right now, I'm going to go over all the tools you're going to need to either take it apart or put it back together. So let's go through it. On the ratchet side, as always, we're going to have a 3/8 1/4 inch. You're going to have various sockets associated with that, ranging from an 8 up to a 17. The only oddball one is this thin-walled 16. On the Allen side, you need to go all the way down to a 3 and up to this 14. On the extensions, you want to have varying lengths to get in and around the engine. Just makes life simpler. The wrench side, really short, just a 10 and a 12. Decent set of side cutters, needle nose pliers, a couple of different pick tools. Always like having a little magnet extension as well. Never hurts to have around. A couple of standard screwdrivers, flat blade and Phillips. And then you also want to have a good breaker bar. You also want to have a good torque wrench because it's going to be definitely needed when we go to put everything back together. Now, if you would, reference our exploded parts diagrams. That's going to give you a very clear picture of how everything's going to come apart, and more importantly, how it's going to go back together. So once you've got your tools and your parts together, we can go over there and I can walk you through it. So let's go. All right, guys, before we dive into this, I've been looking at the cylinder that came off of it, and it doesn't look to be in too terrible of condition. What you are looking for is you still want to be able to see the cross hatches in there. And I can still see remnants of it, but what you do not want to see are any marks that are vertical, because that means that they've been scoring in and erasing where those hatch marks are. Now, I could probably take this and just rehone it using a ball type hone, and it only takes a couple of swipes, because unlike older cylinders where you had an aluminum casting and then you had a metal insert or a sleeve, this doesn't have that. It is raw aluminum that's been plated. I believe this one is using Nicosil. So if you wear past that Nicosil when you're honing it out, it's game over. It's not going to seal and it's not going to do what it's supposed to do. So all that being said, I'm going to go ahead and replace mine. If you feel like you want to try honing yours to bring it back, go for it. But I'm telling you, be very careful and use a very fine grit, 320, 400, somewhere in that neighborhood. So let me go grab the piston, and then I'm going to show you how to place the rings on it. What I typically do is go ahead and just mark on the top of the piston where each ring end gap should be. That makes it really easy when you're actually putting them together. All right, with this being the exhaust side facing forward, this is the intake side. What you want to do on your very top ring is come off 30 degrees off axis. So you want the top ring to end up here. All right, your second ring you want off axis, almost 180 degrees from the top one. So it's going to be here. All right, next is going to be your upper oil ring, which is I'm going to mark here, which is 30 degrees off axis. Then D is actually your oil expander ring. All right, it is going to be another 15 to 20 degrees off of your top ring. So it's going to end up there. And then E, which is your bottom oil ring, is going to be 30 degrees off axis from the bottom here. All right, before we actually put the wrist pin through there, let's go ahead and put one of our pin circlips in place. We'll do it on the outside. And what you're wanting to do is you want the end of the clip to end up down in this section. I think right about there will do. And let's just walk it in there. When you get this last little edge right here, make sure that you don't scratch the piston on the inside. There we go. It's pointing about right here, which is fine. I just don't want it over in this section. Now, let's go ahead and put some oil inside where the wrist pin is going to go. Now, with that done, we can go ahead and carry the piston over, get it connected to the connector rod. All right, at this point, you want to make sure you still got your towels in place here, because we're about to put in the other circlip and you do not want it to fall into the bottom of your engine should you miss. Before we actually put the rings on, let's go ahead and get our dowels in place as well as that cylinder base gasket. Be careful not to push your piston around too much and get it scarred up. Let's get that lower gasket on. There she goes. Now, let's go ahead and start getting our rings on. We want to start with an oil ring expander, which is going to be D. Take a little bit of oil and you just want to wet it all the way around. Just a light coat. When you're putting this on, you want to make sure that the ends actually butt together. You do not want them to overlap like that. That should do it. Next, we can go for that lower ring, which is going to be E. But I want to keep my finger on the end of that oil ring so they don't jump out. It's okay to do what I call spiral these on, but you don't want to use this technique with the top two rings. I'll explain that in a few minutes. So we're going to put that there and then gently spiral it around to that lower ring position, like that. Now we're going to bring the upper oil ring over to C. All right, so our oil ring is now together. Feels nice and even all the way around. All right, guys, we got two rings left. The darker of the two is going to be your second ring, and then this shinier one is going to be the top. The top one is thicker than the second, so it wouldn't go in that middle section anyway. But what you do want to notice is there's a T stamped on each one. We want to make sure that faces up. Just take a little dab of oil, coat it all the way around. This is going to be our B ring. And when you're doing this, you want to pull it out evenly and don't let it bend one way or another, and then drop it in. There it is. Let's bring it around to B without disturbing the oil ring. Same thing for the top ring, A. Make sure you've got your T facing up. Put a thin layer of oil all the way around it. And then we're going to turn it, make sure it doesn't bother the other ring, and bring it around to A. Now I'll take a little bit more oil and put it on the skirts on either side of the piston. Now, it doesn't matter if you're installing a new cylinder or one that you just honed, but you want to make very, very sure that you get this clean. So what I'm going to do, spray it down, a little bit of parts cleaner, and then get all of that wiped out. Just want to make sure there's no deposits. When they ship them out, they typically have a coating in there. So I bet you when I pull this out, it's gonna have some of that sediment on there. And it does. See, that we did not want on our brand new piston and rings. So with that cleaned up, let's go ahead and get some oil in the cylinder. Just a light coating, because we actually do want the rings to bite into the surface so that they seat properly. All right. Let's see if we can get our cylinder back on. What we're gonna do is pass this magnet through, pick up the chain, hold it out of the way as we bring the cylinder down on it. Push our piston rings in from either side, one at a time, and then kind of walk the cylinder down on it. It's just a matter of me getting everything in the right position and walking it down like that. There we go. Now, lift up our chain, finish walking it down. All right, with that in place, let's go ahead and put in that single bolt over here. You want to be careful here if your machine is still dirty, but you don't want to knock anything off of the frame rails or this cross member that may have dirt on it, and then it fall in the engine. And that bolt's going to be torqued to 7 foot-pounds. Now, let's go ahead and put in our chain guide. My front one was a little bit worn, so I decided to go ahead and replace it. Put a little bit of oil the length of it. Lift up our chain and go ahead and get her in place. Now, let's go ahead and get our dowel pins pushed in, and then we can put in our head gasket. All right, she's in place. Now, let's go ahead and bring the head down, and we're gonna bring the chain up through. Now, I'd already taken some of that parts cleaner and just a really soft brush and cleaned out the combustion chamber. It's ready to go. I have not disturbed where my valve tappets, and more importantly, the shims were when it was taken apart. So they're gonna be going back in the same location. But just in case one of them or two of them fell out, I went ahead and numbered them. That was just a precaution. And it looks like she's sitting flush. Let's go ahead and get these other two 8mm on this side in place. Same 7 foot-pounds. And then we'll put in the head bolts, get those torqued down. All right, guys, Yamaha has an interesting torque sequence for this particular model. What we're gonna do is put a little bit of grease, now that I've got the bolts cleaned up, around this washer. Remember, that's just on the washers. That's the only place we want it. We're gonna drop all four of them in. And we're gonna take them down in a sequence to 22 foot-pounds. The sequence is 1, 2, 3, and 4. At that point, I'm gonna relieve tension. Make them loose again. 2, 3, and 4. Then take them back down in the same sequence to 14 foot-pounds. 2, 3, and 4. And at that point, we do the sequence again, but we're gonna turn them 90 degrees. Here is where you either need a degree wheel or to mark your bolts with just a black marker. This particular torque wrench I have, it actually calculates angles. So I'm gonna use it to do it. And then when we're done with that, we're gonna do the same sequence one more time, 90 degrees. Interesting concept, huh? All right, with all that jostling around, I guarantee you that our crankshaft is no longer at top dead center. So let's get that reset, leave a wrench on it, keep it in place, hold it still, and then we'll start working on the cam timing. It was maybe 2 or 3 degrees off. All right, we're just gonna leave that hanging right there. So now let's go ahead and coat both the buckets and the surfaces that the cam rides on with a little bit of assembly lube, and then we're gonna carry the cams over. Tell you what, let's add a little bit more, at least to the lobes, because I do not want this thing starving at first start. All right, if you were watching the video when we took it apart, the way we want these to end up, the lobes to be facing up, and this little divot right here is gonna be even with the edge of the top of the head. Not this one, the one down here. This is gonna signify that you are at the top dead center of the compression stroke. Same thing over here. The divot that you're gonna want to be in line is that one right there. So when we get them in this position, it's gonna be timed correctly. All right, let's start wiggling them in there. We'll start with the exhaust first, because that actually pulls against the front of the engine, which is the fixed chain guide. That's looking good. Let's verify it down the crankshaft. Make sure we're still on our mark. Remember, it's the single mark, not the double. Yep, we are there. So this is what we were looking for, like I showed you on the bench. Dot, dot, and the lobes are up. So, a little bit more assembly lube. Let's go and get those caps on. Put your clip, put it in that little groove on the bearing. Go ahead and do the exhaust first. That feels right. Let's go ahead and do the intake as well. All right, that's in place. Got our dowels lined up. It's holding onto that clip. Timing still looks good. Let's go and get these bolts in. May want to put a little bit of oil on the threads. We're going to take these to 7 foot-pounds. 1, 2, 3, 4. And this one's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yep, we're good. All right, next, let's get our chain tensioner ready to go. What we have here is you remove this bolt, get it out of the way. Got our new gasket that's gonna be going in. And you'll notice there are two bolts that you took out. And I hope you paid attention, because if the engine is facing this direction, the inside bolt is the one with this little copper washer. The one on the outside doesn't have one. Once you've got that in place and ready to go, we need to go ahead and reset the tensioner because you can't push it back in right now. The reason for taking out that bolt is to take a flat blade screwdriver, and then we want to screw it all the way back in, and it'll have a small section to where it'll latch. That you even so much as breathe on it and it's gonna pop loose. Other thing you wanna make sure of, there's a little stamp right here that says up. So of course we want that facing up. So we've got our outside bolt, we've got our inside bolt, we've got our new washer. Try not to bump anything. And now we're gonna go mount it to the bike. I feel like I'm carrying a bomb over here. Once we get at least one of these mounting bolts all the way down without it releasing, we've won the battle. Screw it all the way down. And then we're gonna reach in there and just tap that bolt on the inside, or that adjustment screw on the inside, and that'll release the tension and it's gonna push against the chain. Last but not least, don't forget this little end cap bolt. All right, let's get our valve cover ready to roll. We're putting in a new gasket, and we are also replacing these two washers that are up top because they're all made out of rubber. And rubber, as you know, after a while gets hard and then cracks and then fails. Notice that this piece right here, we actually need to cut it out. It is not supposed to stay on there. What Yamaha also wants you to do is use a thin layer of Yamaha 1215 or equivalent all the way around on this surface. And then once we set that in there, then we're gonna put it on the lobes that go down to the head on the other surface. So we're just gonna put a thin layer. It's not gonna take much. Now, let's go ahead and set this in place. Now we're gonna go over these two half moons. All right, we're all gooped up. Let's get her back in there. And now we've got our two new little washer slash seals going up top. Tighten these down till they bottom out. You'll feel it when it bottoms. There. All right, next, let's go ahead and get our crankshaft cover and that inspection hole for the timing. And make sure that you're not missing your O-rings on either one. All right, the small one's a 6, and the larger one is a 14. Now let's get that spark plug in. I want to give you a little bit of advice that I've gotten mainly from the personal watercraft world. These spark plugs are notoriously thin where the threads go into the base of the spark plug. And this one came out, but I want you to look at all the corrosion on there that was starting to build up. Now what was in danger of happening? Snap. Threads stay in, top part comes out. Then guess what? You're having to pull this all the way apart. So long story short, I always put a little bit of anti-seize on the threads before I put them in there. And also remember, you have to have a thin wall 16 to get down into the head to tighten it back down. And now we want to torque that to 9 foot-pounds. Well, all right, guys, that pretty much finishes up the top end engine build, but there's still a lot left to do, but we're gonna carry that over until the next video. What all is gonna be entailed? Well, we're gonna be dealing with the intake, the exhaust, the cooling system, getting it refilled with oil, get the gas tank back on it, get all the plastics put back together, and then fire it up for the first time. Well, listen, we do wanna say thank you for shopping here with us at Partzilla.com. We really enjoy doing what we do and making your life easier, showing you how to do these different projects. So if you like seeing me work on these machines, why don't you subscribe to our channel? That way you'll know and you'll be able to see what I'm up to next. So until next time, we just want to say thank you, and we will see you in the next video.